Father God, we thank you for the privilege to be alive and to be a part of what you're doing in the world. Thank you for making us aware of your presence, to a great degree of the awareness even of your purpose. Thank you for helping us to understand how you have defined humanity. We pray that you'd help us to more fully understand it and also to embrace it for ourselves and for others. Lord, amidst all the dreams that have been presented and declared and in some ways forced upon humanity throughout the thousands of years that we've been here, we thank you for the grace and for the work of the Spirit in causing your vision to really excel in our generation and in those to come. Please continue, Lord God, to work in us and through us, because it's in you that we live and we move and have our being. We trust you with our very lives, Lord, today, and we thank you for your mindfulness in our hearts. Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. Good to see you here today. Throughout this month, we have been ministering on another topic, but a week ago Friday night, I believe it was, we were able to talk a little bit more about, begin a discussion a little bit more in line with the theme nationally for this time of year in the United States of America, just in case you're watching this from some other nation. Every February, we have celebrated in some way the actual existence and contribution of black people in America. There's been a lot of disagreement over whether or not that's necessary in more recent times, primarily because the emphasis on black history in some ways segregated that one particular aspect of history from the rest. And so you will hear statements like, black history is American history, and I certainly believe that. I think that's true. There is a reason, though, why Carter G. Woodson and some others wanted to focus. Of course, in their time, they were dealing more with Jim Crow-ism and coming out of Reconstruction, and prior to that, slavery. The degradation of the value of the humanity of black people. Many, many churches today, pastors, are involved in the social justice movement because of that degradation and the multi-generational impact that it's had. And so that's just one reason. There are many other reasons, part of which is just an almost seemingly insurmountable distrust on the part of even many black Christians or Christians who are black. For those who are white, whether they're white Christians or white, period. Our system has our nation has gone through a lot of discussions and arguments and battles and even war over the issue. And so I take the time each year to talk a little bit about this in a particular way, because I believe that what God has in mind for us is that we would truly understand his heart concerning the issue. And while we do celebrate many of the things that God has used persons of my ancestry to do, and people like us who are black in America, there is also a tendency at times, if we're not careful, to belittle others, those who are not black, and those who have also made insurmountable, incalculable, priceless contributions to who we are as a nation and what we are about. And while we may not always agree or even view some of those contributions or those acts or commitments as equal in value, it is important to acknowledge the fact that we are not here just because of what black people have done. God has used us, and many, many things have been bettered over the years since those days. During this time then, what we try to do is, and God gave me to do this decades ago, is to kind of enlarge our understanding. I can't do that. God has to do that. But to kind of enlarge our understanding of what it means to be the people of God and how he really wants us to live and to think, okay? And so to that end, that's kind of where I'm going with this. During Black History Month, as we celebrate, as we honor, if you've been at Metro, you know we don't really have a lot of festivities in relationship to that. We've shown some things, discussed some things. And that's because of what I'm going to be talking to you about today as well. I've entitled this particular message, God's Privileged Race. I do not mean by the title, I'll just put this disclaimer in right now. I do not mean by the title, God's Privileged Race, what has come down the pike over the centuries to somehow suggest that God has this kind of prejudicial, biased attitude that has been expressed through some people who say that they are the people of God. God in no way, shape, or form is trying to force anyone to become a part of his people. We've had that too, unfortunately. For those of us who've had the privilege and the responsibility of study academically, church history, Christian history, some would call it, Old Testament history, intertestamental history, history period, you know, like I know, that the church does not have a spotless record in this particular area. There have been many things that were done that causes shame, us to bow our heads, because there's been so much junk in the midst of all of this. And so the comments that I'm making today, they're not being made because the people group that I'm talking about and will be talking about are better than anybody else. We are better off, but we're not better in terms of the true value of a human being. We don't mean more to God than anyone else. God loves the world, even those who don't believe that he exists. He loves everybody. And so in light of that, I want to talk a little bit under the theme that we normally have during this month. I call it ethnic unity in Christ. You hear a lot about diversity, equity, and inclusion today if you are kind of in the know or you're involved on your jobs, human resource managers and coordinators and supervisors and directors. That's one of the major responsibilities, to make sure that that particular spirit is maintained, supposedly even in Christian organizations and so forth. This, again, in my judgment, is the world's way of trying to make sure that the value of every human being is honored and acknowledged so that we can be a better people in a better place. I think it was the Declaration of Independence that included the phrase to promote the general welfare, and to ensure the blessings of liberty and prosperity to all. And so if you don't have Christ in your life, or if you don't believe that Jesus Christ is really the way, the truth, and the life, whatever your particular philosophical, ideological, or religious, or spirituality type of view may be, what we experience in our world today is kind of a conglomeration, an amalgamation of all of those thoughts. And depending upon the time or the season or the generation in which you are alive, that amalgamation somehow seems to emphasize certain aspects of all those different views at that time. And of course, those of us who are in the body of Christ, we have been given the charge of not only including our message, but also living the life that actually says to the world that this is really how God intended that humanity be, what he really desires. I think one of the most eye-opening experiences for me as a black kid growing up and then later a young man and now an older man in the world and in the at large and in the church has been that in many ways we have not really communicated that message well. Sometimes in our anger, in our hurt, in our confusion, in our fatigue, we have really just kind of almost thrown in the towel on it and in some ways become an island unto ourselves and failed to do what God really has called us to do. As I have aged over time, things really have gotten better. They really have. Some people hate for you to say that because it gives them the impression that a statement like that means that, there is no racism or there is no problem. There are lots of problems. There are huge problems. They still exist. But, I'm standing in this building today. I have earned college degrees, including a doctorate. Money's been made available. I'm living in a neighborhood that my grandfather could not even think about living in, let alone live there. So to act as though nothing has changed would be a lie. It would be very deceptive. And also it would be disingenuous to assume that all people who are the descendants of many of the oppressors of black people in America, number one, agreed with their ancestors, and number two, lived their lives to completely make sure that all black people are gonna suffer until we leave the earth. That would be a lie. Much of what has happened in terms of even the progress has been on the part of whites and Asians and Hispanics and others who've really committed their lives to making the world better. Gotta hasten to say in the midst of that, many of them were not Christians and they didn't necessarily believe in Christianity or in Christ or all of that. They just simply believed in something called the intrinsic goodness of man, that somehow, some way, in all of our messed up ways of looking at things, that if you worked hard at it, you would be able to touch that part of another human being, and out of a sense of humanitarian concern, there would be a change. And that did seem to prove true, at least at some level. I'm saying all that to say that what I'm talking about today not only is an attempt to acknowledge that, but also to say to you that it failed. And that there is only one thing that will really produce what we're trying to accomplish. Only one thing. And it's becoming a part of God's privileged race. We hear a lot about white privilege today, and so and economic privilege and class privilege. And because of that, a title like this could really throw you. Hopefully by the time I'm done, you'll understand why that title is there. Okay, so let's try this one more time. See if we can get this going. There we go. Race in history and in culture, and even to a certain degree in the scientific world, is thought of in the following ways. Now, let me say this as well. When we talk, I'm kind of a word buff. And you see that in my style of teaching and all of that. And I don't define words because I think you're stupid or because I think that you don't already know the definitions and that kind of thing. I do it because I know that we can assume that we mean the same thing. And that in a very simple conversation between parents and children or spouses, there can be total disagreement without even knowing it when people are using the same words. I love you, you love me, but they mean something different. And so we find it necessary to take the time to break down what's meant. Then we can talk and we can build and make certain steps together. So that's the goal. It's important as well to understand that when we talk about words as well, eventually we have to get back to the source of the meaning. For the most part, when you study how meanings are developed, the field is called epistemology, and a branch of that is linguistics and philology and etymology and a bunch of other 50-cent words that we won't go into. But the point here is, in my own personal study, is that I've discovered that the meaning of words come to us primarily out of human rational decision-making or what a person has experienced, to the point that there is a general consensus that that means that because of, you know, the rational, the logical way that it's been communicated, that this is what this experience means or this feels like. Of course, there's one problem. The problem with that is that when we start talking about God and what he means by things, the assumption is that we mean the same thing that he does. God has chosen to condescend and use some of these words use the natural languages that are developed throughout the various societies and civilizations. But it is important to take a look at what he means. And how do we do that? Well, we have to go to the Bible, but we also have to really catch this. We have to really listen for his approval on the meaning. For the average person in the world, that's nonsense, absolutely crazy. I was listening to a conversation between Joe Rogan, is that the guy's name, and some other person. He's a famous podcaster, YouTube podcaster, and almost every other word was the F-bomb or some other word. He was talking about Christians and how we just make things up, and that the meanings of things really are ludicrous to us. And as I was listening to him, at first, you know, I got a little irritated. And the Lord reminded me that his understanding is not what ours is. And he doesn't get it. And I don't mean I'm better than him. I just mean just what I said. He doesn't get it. And so that's how it looks to him. And when we think in terms of what anything means, what the actual meaning of it is, if you're blind or you're deaf to the input of God, the only logical conclusion is the meaning is whatever you understand it to be, whatever you've experienced. And so that puts the Christian in a precarious situation. We now must really depend upon God. We must really depend upon God to do the part that only he can do in communicating meaning. Now, I just spent that last 5 minutes saying all that so that when I go through this, you will kind of understand where I'm coming from with this, because this is a multi-millennial war. And it's the word game where we've lost it. It's the word war. Before there was a bomb, before there was any of that stuff, technologically, in whatever era, it was the word game that got lost. Has God said that you're not to eat of any of the trees of the garden? It's the word game. That's how this particular sinister arch enemy of God works. He goes to that level because that is an abstract, very clear battlefield. Most divorces, most breakups, and all of the stuff that we can list here today is over the meaning of what you said and did. And the same is true in the issues that we have with God and the issues that we have with each other, and certainly in this issue of race. Later on, maybe next month, we'll take some time and walk through some of the slavery issue and some of the passages that really, really are troubling. that has to be dealt with in order to understand what God really meant by even allowing it. But it's very, very important. People outside of this setting, you know, think that the church isn't thinking, that we're not thinking people, we're not critical thinkers, that all we do is we come for the catharsis, we come for the emotional release. And as soon as we get our emotional release, then we go back to the real world to deal with real problems. Yeah, you just kind of went there and got your little praise on, you did your little do, and you know, got a few preachers up in there that pontificated about their ideas, but in the real world, what are you going to do now? So they really don't think that we think in that world. We just kind of parrot and regurgitate what we were told to say and what we were told to believe. As preachers dangle our feet over hell, and if we don't agree with them. I mean, it's pretty true. And there are some people that really respect us. I don't want to broad brush them. They really respect us. They respect our right to believe what we believe, do what we do, act like we act, you know, get our praise on or whatever else we want to do. But when it gets right down to it, they really don't think we get it. They don't. They think that we are trying to get them to become like us, mindless, illogical, emotional, spiritual, religious people. Okay? All right. So I wanna talk to you. Did I do that? Okay. All right. I want to talk to you today about this because it's very, very important that we cover it. From a historical and a cultural and a scientific standpoint, race really has to do with a competitive and an athletic event, you know, like the Olympics or something like that, or just little league stuff. And then it also had more of a figurative meaning, kind of in light of the, people want to know why does it have the impact that it does? Because it touches all of life. Okay, your dude out there winning is you. Your guy standing up underneath the pressure, that's you. When you got to go back to the real world. So there's a major connection between the boy hitting the three-pointer with 2 seconds on the clock and you making it in all of these other figurative ways of the race. There's political races and social, economic, and military and scientific pursuits toward the goal of victory. It's a race, political race, military race, arms race, scientific race, so forth and so on. And then there's race, as we all know, in terms of humanity, humankind, a species, right? This is comprised, from the current cultural view, it's comprised of multiple different types or stocks or kinds of people, Caucasian, Negroid, Semitic, mongrel, some would describe that, and others that you just saw in the video. But essentially, race for the most part is thought of as subcategories or subgroups of humanity. Some would distinguish them as separate races. That's pretty much still the common mentality. You know, there is the white race, the black race, you know, the Asians, there's Semitic, there's, you know, whatever we would name. So we have this, I'm sorry, I misspelled this. We have this plurality of groups or races and not just one singly shared sense of essence or human nature. Each one of these is different. And Carl Linnaeus and some of the others, you know, really championed that view. And it's unfortunate. Race and history and culture, then we have this kind of superior mentality versus this inferior stock or kind. It's absolutely amazing. When I went 50 years ago to visit my friend, many of you know Dr. Dale Conaway, we've been friends since high school here, and he went to Tuskegee, I went to ORU, but he stayed in touch with me, and I went there to sing and preach, and they started a ministry on campus that's still going on. And so I went and kind of walked through Tuskegee and was looking at some of the stuff that you normally don't see. And literally was there. I mean, you know, the projects and the comparison of the black man to the ape and the size of his brain and the statement, supposedly scientific statement that the black man was inferior. And here are the pictures. And many of you know about the syphilis project and all of that, right? Why would they test that on them? Because they're inferior. Well, it caused you to get mad, but that was the simple mentality. You know, you have a superior one, you have the inferior. In this case, it's the whites who were superior, and the black and Indians and others who are inferior. And of course, in our culture today, we do have an emphasis on diversity, acknowledging each other's difference, equity, a sense of not just equality of opportunity, but also equality of outcomes. And the goal is to get everybody to the place where we all have kind of the same outcome. Now, the Marxist mentality with all of this, you know, is very interesting, and I don't want to go into that, but the point that we want to emphasize here is that there can be, you know, possibly equality of opportunity sometimes, but it's hard to really get equality of results all the time, because everyone's, you know, IQ is different, your talents are different, our aptitudes are different, our affinities and proclivities, they're all different. So when we deal with, you know, an individual who can bench press 300 pounds and treat a person who can only bench press 100 pounds as if you're going to get the same outcome, you're not going to get the same outcome. The ability level is different. But there is also an effort to include everyone. I mentioned my friend Carlton Pearson, not to, you know, Brandon, but he got off into this and tried to read into scripture some of this, which was just way off. And we had a lot of disagreements over a period of about 18, 20 years, on the phone, through text messages, all the rest. Unless they all are erased, you know, I can show it to you. In fact, last January, we went to a mutual friend's homegoing celebration. We were joking and teasing each other and laughing, and I started talking about our debate. And he said, yeah, there's enough in there to create a book. I said, yeah, it probably is. Just write it all down. I said, I don't want to write it down. I don't want to put it in a book. I just want to kind of talk with you. Let's work this. Come some good. But, you know, on the surface, inclusion sounds so, it sounds so cool, you know. It's, who doesn't want to include people? Bigots, homophobes, transphobes, religious zealots. That's who doesn't want to include anybody. People that think they're better than somebody, right? It's the superiors, particularly the religious people who are superior in their mind. They think they're better than everybody else, who don't want to include. In the base of inclusion, as with all of these other terms, no matter how they sound, is a different meaning. And I remember saying to him several times, Carlton, God's already included everybody. He said, what do you mean? Remember, Carlton, whosoever will, let him come. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Well, the Bible is really not the word of God. See, that's the way you get out of it. Yeah, but still, even if you don't believe it's the word of God, God has already included everybody. There's no need for some massive new movement on inclusion. The word war is over what it means to include and why we're including. Included for what? Unto what? you know, included so we can make the world a better place. What does that mean? What does it mean to make the world a better place? I mean, really, what does that mean? There are people that have died on battlefields all over the world to protect America and to help America become a, and the world become a democratic, more democratic society, to promote the general welfare, to ensure the blessings of liberty and prosperity to all. Now that's the good. That's the good. And however you get there spiritually, that's cool too. If you're Buddhist or Hindu or Islamic or Christian or Jewish, or even if you're none of that, if you're atheist, if you are agnostic, if you're free thinking, if you are whatever, it's all good. It's all good. What does good mean? Pastor, you're just being nitpicky. No, I'm not. I'm really not. If you ask me to give my life for this, what does good mean? What are you being included for? What is the call of inclusion to? What is the general welfare? How do you promote it? What's the difference between a classic democratic society and a democratic republic and a constitutional republic? That was the battle. What's the difference in a society ruled by the people or ruled by the representatives of the people? What's the shade of difference? What's the difference between a society ruled by a constitutional document that the representatives are supposed to uphold so that the people's voice is heard and honored? That's what the battle was over. Yeah, so this is not a lazy, ignorant question. What are you being included? What are you being called to inclusion for? And what role are the good old religious, churchy Christian people are supposed to play in that? Because we're at war over this. In November this year, there's going to be another general election, and at the end of it, we're going to be split. Whoever wins. Because roughly about 49, 48, or 50% of the people are going to still believe we got shafted, and now we got to take the next 4 years to get it back. I know you don't believe for 1 minute that we're going to rationally arrive at the place in November where that's all going to be changed. It's a word war. It's a word war. We've committed our lives, our honor, our sacred fortune to this. All those guys lost everything, all of them. Study the history. They lost it all, everything, to promote the general welfare and to secure the blessings of liberty and prosperity for all. They lost everything for that. And for those of us who are born again believers, the question is, was it worth it? And in some measure, we can say, yes, look at where we are. We're sitting here. We have our problems, we've got our issues, but if not the greatest, it is one of the greatest nations on the face of the earth. Was it worth it? Did we reach the goal? Are we still in process? That's the point here. So diversity, equity, and inclusion is a part of this whole issue as it deals with race, including everybody, because obviously if you read the history, even without studying it. In life today, there are people that struggle with equity and with inclusion. Race and history and culture then exists, whether you know you have this one human race mentality or the diverse stock thing, exists for diverse personal, familial, communal, national, global, religious, spiritual, and non-religious or atheistic reasons with diverse purposes and perspectives. And when we all sit down at the table to try to make the world a better place, that diversity makes it very difficult for us to reach and even establish what the goal is. Let me put it another way. For the Christian, it becomes even more problematic because now we're being called to support and give our lives for something that we really do not necessarily believe is going to promote the general welfare, or it's not going to promote the prosperity of all. In fact, it's going to hurt us. I.e., that's the reason why we have the struggles that we do with abortion and with homosexuality and the LGBTQAI plus community and all the rest. That's the reason why we have the struggle with capitalism in this country, you know, the exploitive kind. Capitalism, for the most part, as I understand scripture, you know, it's a cool thing, it's good, yeah, it really is. But, you know, with human nature involved, it can be predatory. I mean, you can charge $10 for a loaf of bread, right? I mean, it can happen. It was paying 35 cents in Venezuela for gas, but up here, we wouldn't send 35 cents for gas, right? I read the article the other day, it says, not even read, I saw the video. And the question, how much does it cost to make an iPhone? Anybody want to guess? $10. Through the use of exploitive slave type labor. Everybody against slavery? Are you against buying an iPhone? Everybody working for social justice? Willing to turn in your iPad? If you know how it really got manufactured? Yeah, this is a lot more. This is a lot more involved than we think. It's a lot more involved than that. Yelling and screaming at a particular people group's descendants because of whatever. And we're making some valid points, but by the same token, we've got to turn the light on, you know, me, too. Am I really for equity? Am I really for justice? Am I really for including everybody? And how's that look when it gets down to how much I pay for stuff? And whether or not I will boycott your behind until you adjust it. See, this is, and what's the role of a Christian in all of this? I said, Pastor, what do you got to do with ethnic unity? Everything. Can you imagine what the people feel like who labor, like being in a slave camp for something that's really about $10 and very little of the profit gets translated into their pockets where they can actually move out of tenements with 3 and 4 and 5 families living in the same place? Yeah, there is predatory capitalism. You know, but there's an economic race. There's a financial profitability race going on. Because everybody knows it's not enough just to make money. You got to make enough money that makes money. You got to make enough money that makes enough money to keep you in power. The name of the game is not just simply making money. The name of the game is market share. It's not just making money. You can make money and lose it in a month if you don't really have a sustainable kind of posture economically that can keep you viable and doing well. Pastor, you know that? Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. So there are all kind of diverse purposes and perspectives when it comes to race and when it comes to the purpose for race. And as we've seen, even in some of the so-called scientific racism, not only papers but also practices, it led to so many, many horrible things. Now, race in scripture appears also as a competitive athletic event. Turn your Bibles there, please, real quickly to Ecclesiastes. I want to read a couple of these. Ecclesiastes 9, if you can find it for me, we can put it up, and then I'll go back, and then we'll look at 1 Corinthians 9 a little bit. Ecclesiastes 9, verse 11. I already am aware that for many individuals, the Bible means absolutely nothing. And please forgive me, I don't mean to sound crass by saying that, but it's true. It doesn't mean anything to them. But, you know, I don't stop teaching you because it doesn't mean anything to you. Right? That's not right. Because you haven't seen its value yet doesn't diminish what it really means. It says, I returned and saw under the sun that the race, see, this is one Solomon's observation, the race is not to the swift, nor the battle, another kind of race, to the strong, nor bread to the wise, nor riches to men of understanding, nor favor to men of skill, but time and chance happened to all of them. Okay, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. So just showing you in the scripture that when the Bible talked about race, it does actually talk about a competitive event. I'm tempted to teach on that verse, but we don't have time, all right? Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 9, okay? And I think it's around verse 23 that we need to get to. Let's see. Paul is talking here about why he's involved in ministry. Next verse, please. Do you not know that those who run, he's talking about his life in the ministry, those who run in a race all run. See, human, in this case, a foot race. But one receives the prize. So he tells us, metaphorically speaking, now, like the people run with their feet, you're in a race. Run in such a way that you may obtain it. Obtain what? The prize for those who have been called and who are involved in the kingdom of God, in the church of the living God. So this is a spiritual kind of race. Got a foot race, and then Paul immediately uses this foot race to say, here is what your life is like as a believer. You're involved in a race. There's some competition. Your competition, though, is not each other, right? It's not your brother and your sister in the Lord. It's not the pastor. It's not any of that. It's sin. It's the devil. It's the flesh. That's your competition. Your competition is not each other. Born again believers. Next verse, please. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate. This particular version has the mastery over his own body in all things. Now, they do it. They do what? They compete to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. So again, the point here is that those of us who are involved in this spiritual race, we're in competition with some forces that are against us winning the prize. Paul referred to it as the upward call of God in Christ Jesus in the book of Philippians. Now, he's not talking about salvation. Salvation is not, it is a prize, but it's a prize that was won for us, and Jesus makes it a gift. The gift of salvation. But this is talking about the prize for those, or an award or reward that is given to those who compete properly. Without going too much into this, this was the way that Paul, and he uses the imagery here. Those who are familiar with the Greek Isthmian Games, the Olympian Games, the Nemean Games, so forth, they were called. If you were a contestant, you know, you had about three different types of trainers. You went into training for about 10 months to 12 months. You left your home. You trained very rigorously. You had a certain diet. You had a guy that was there, kind of a general guy, and you had a person that was a specialty guy. You had a person that was there to really kind of rub you down after it was all over. And so this was all a part of your training. If you won the prize, you know, you walked away, we call them medals today. If you won the prize, we were in Greece last last year, 40th wedding anniversary, we went by one of the stadiums that had been built in the 19th century. And but if you won the prize, the prize included distinction and honor. It didn't just, wasn't nearly money. It was a laurel wreath or some type of wreath that you wore around your head. And in many towns, if you won, they created a statue out of you, and they would put your name up. And some made you tax-free for the rest of your life. That was cool, right? Right? And so Paul says, but that's a perishable crown. The crown, the Greek term here again is for a reward. This is a victor's crown, something you work for and you get. It's not your salvation. It's not our salvation. Jesus, what he did, earned that. But now, having received that in right position before the Lord, now we live our lives in faithfulness to him, and we're in this spiritual race. All right? Okay, let's go back, please, to our you take me back there to my PowerPoint, and I'm going to just walk the... So it was a competitive athletic event, and then we see how the metaphor gets flipped over, even without the word of God using the word race. For that, I showed you from 1 Corinthians chapter 9 how it kind of got flipped into a metaphorical use for social, political, economic, religious, spiritual, scientific, and even military pursuits. It's all present in Scripture, this whole race mentality, this competition against the forces. Now, if you walked out there and you competed against your coach, and you spend time competing against the people that was training you, you're fighting them the whole time, you're probably going to lose. Which is what happens a lot in church and a lot in marriage and a lot of family stuff. We spend most of our time fighting the people that are there to help us and fighting the people that's really in our corner, you know. They're really for us, but they got to tell you some things sometimes, that you're too slow, you eat too much, you're eating the wrong thing, you're not getting the kind of rest you need. You don't want to hear that because, you know, you're bad. You know you're bad. You got what's going on. You can do it all day long and all night long. Without any rest, that you're the ever bunny. You can do it until you get out there with folks just as good as you or better. And then you realize, ooh, maybe I should have laid off of the Twinkies. Right? Because, you know, you get your behind beat. Now, for brothers, that's really devastating. I know some sisters can hang with it better than us, but for brothers, that's really devastating. We ain't gonna lose. We'd rather walk away with a broke nose than lose. Amen, brothers, help me out up here. Yeah, see, it's, Brother Lucas said, well, no, I don't think I'll care about the broke nose. All right, so there, you see this in Scripture, though. I wish we had time. David, Goliath, some of the others, you see these military types of things. There are many social and political and economic things there. Then the Bible speaks about race, not only in terms of a foot race or even the metaphorical competitions that we have, but also as humanity. Humanity is a race in the general sense of the word. Genesis chapter 1, 26, 28. Several have pointed this out, that when God created all the other aspects of the creation, he spoke to, and it was created. But then when he wanted to create humankind, he spoke within and amongst himself. Himself being, you know, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he created this body, and then he breathed into this body, and that which had never existed before came into existence as a result of the breath of God, the human spirit. Man became a living nefesh, or a living soul, a being. That Hebrew term really speaks of the entirety of not just the inside, but the outside as well. When you get into Greek tries to break all that up and be more compartmentalized with it. But the word of the Lord is that the human being really is the result of the breath of God. That's God's narrative about where we come from and who we are. And yet we are not God. God is omniscient. He knows all things and is all wise. God is omnipresent. He's everywhere at the same time. We aren't. And we are not omniscient. God's all powerful. We're not. So we didn't become God. But we bear and we resemble certain aspects of his nature and character. That's who the human being is. Now, I understand there are thousands and thousands of years of different perspectives and narratives about this, but this is what God's word says. This is what God has said in his word about us. By the way, everyone that's believed the other narratives and lived according to those narratives and all the stuff that breaks out of that, they have never really fully produced a human being that was maximized and living the highest quality. Never. The only one that has been able to do it is God. Or if you want to put it another way, if you don't believe in the Bible, what we say God says in his word. By the way, the results are there for him. Genesis 1, 26 to 28, God spoke and said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. And then the scripture says that he created man, or Adam is the Hebrew term. He created Adam, male and female, right? He created Adam, male and female. And he gave to this male and female dominion, rulership, authority over all that he created, to live in harmony with him under his authority and with each other, live under his authority in harmony with each other in their respective roles. We've walked through this several times, so I won't go back through it again. Psalm 8 speaks of this as well. It tells us very clearly, along with Psalm 139, verse 14 and 15, we have been fearfully and wonderfully made. The idea of fearful there means there's a spirit of, or a tone, or an aspect of reverence about our very being. That the human being is sacred to God. See, this is not a sacredness that is to be worshipped. That's where the fallout is. That's where the differences are in other religions and other philosophies. But this is a sacredness nonetheless. And so this idea of the sanctity of life comes out of the scriptures. We're not to be worshipped. We're not to be adored in that sense. But our very composition is to be reverently thought of. We're fearfully and wonderfully made. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Psalm 8 begins and takes us right on through and says, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? For you've made him a little lower than Elohim. Elohim, which was a term that was used for the God of Israel, but also for the other gods of the nations of the people that lived at that time. It's capitalized when it's used in terms of, the God of Israel, obviously those who were writing, and then in other cases. It's interesting, I won't go there, but this is what the Bible says we are. We are this. This is not who we're striving to be. We are this. Got one problem though. Sin infected this creation of God. And the infection of sin affects who we are and how we think and how we reason and who we get involved with. So in the Bible, race in scriptures is single. It's singular, and it's not multiple kinds and types and stocks. It's one. It's one human race. Okay? The spirit in a female body is not inferior to the spirit, the human spirit of in a male body. See? The spirit in a black man's body is not inferior to the spirit in a white woman's body. Spirit in a white woman's body is not inferior to the spirit in a black man's body. There's no inferiority there. There are uniquenesses, there are differences, but in essence, there's equality. And this is what makes you scratch your head when certain people claim to be Christians, supported
Slavery.
When you study the scriptures, you'll discover that men stealing, Paul mentions it in 1 Timothy chapter 1. They're talking about kidnappers and selling people and making them slaves. You know what the punishment for that was according to God's word? Death. So whenever you think of American slavery, you need to understand God was never for that. The penalty for what, how this whole slavery thing happened here, the people who stole us, as well as the people who sold us, including some of our own, the penalty is death. So the lie that's out there by, you know, Sam Harris and all the rest of these folks who are telling you that the Bible condones slavery, these are guys that start with a bias anyway. They don't believe in the existence of God, and they're just trying to show us that we're stupid, dumb, and ignorant for believing in God, and that the book that we call sacred was really written by a bunch of men like us who are fallible and messed up and jacked up. Don't be stupid as far as they're concerned. And I'm definitely not going to fall into your stupidity by believing in your God. That's their point of view. But they didn't study the Bible to come to that conclusion about slavery. Most of them don't. They spent most of their time trying to prove their point that we believe something that's bogus. That's all they really are about. Okay? That's another whole discussion. So we got to put some of this off next month, right? Okay? But this is extremely important to see. God's never been for the kind of slavery that happened in America. Never. Never was for. If he was, why did he deliver Israel? Case in point. All right, so we look at this. Race in scripture then, in terms of humanity, is shared common universal attributes that are human. Equality that is natural and spiritual in nature. The essence of who we are, we're all the same. But there is a diversity in terms of our physical and mental, intellectual and emotional capabilities and attributes, which makes us who we are and brings forth the beauty even and the wonder of the image of God. Okay. And then finally we have in scripture God's special people. Okay? The people that God, and I should have just said God's redeemed people. That's a different race. These are all born again human beings through Jesus Christ. Every person indwelt by the Holy Spirit. If you're born again, the Spirit of Christ, God says in his word in Romans chapter 8, dwells in you. A person that's not born again, the Spirit of Christ does not dwell in them. Again, that does not mean we're better than you. It just simply means that's not your reality. All born again human beings are people, every person who has life in Christ. These are people who are devoted to the kingdom, to the fulfillment of God's eternal purpose in the kingdom of God through his church. You raking on the church, you jacking the church, you don't care nothing about the church and all that. It may be that even though you've attended some of the services, that you are not in it. Not against criticism, not against pointing out our flaws, not against answering for what we've done wrong, not against any of that. But any person that spends most of their time putting the church down doesn't understand. You're fooling with God, you're fooling with Jesus' bride. And no husband that I know who loves his bride takes that very long. With all of her imperfections, doesn't make a difference in that regard. And so we see that God's word says that those of us who are part of this special people are devoted to the fulfillment of God's eternal purpose. What is that?
Promote the general welfare.
No. Those were phrases that we choose to try to do what we keep continuing to try to do. To try to make the call to submission to Jesus Christ more palatable for the average person.
Promote the general welfare, ensure the blessings of liberty and prosperity to all, however it's phrased. Those are little catch-all phrases. It's kind of a little bit of equivocation. You're kind of saying it and you're not kind of saying it. And you just kind of get the impression that whether you are a believer in Jesus Christ or not, we can all work toward this. Promoting the general welfare. Well, what does that mean? Everybody gets a chance to work for land and get a house and, you know, have kids and get married and make money and leave it for your kids. Promote the general welfare. Well, what about your soul? What does it profit a man to gain the whole world if he loses his life? So some of this language, though, we're thankful for it in our Federalist documents, and we're thankful for, you know, study public policy and all that. We're thankful for all of that because it at least kind of gave us a little leverage and kind of tried to put in some kind of understandable language where God is really coming from, but we've gotten confused along the way. We're all working for the same thing. No, we are not. All due respect to those who are followers of Allah, and all due respect to those who are followers of Jehovah, or, you know, Hashem, for those that will not pronounce his name, Jehovah. All due respect to those who follow Shintoism or Confucianism or Zoroastrianism, or those who follow nobody or nothing, who are atheistic or non-theistic. There is a separate message here. It's a clear message. Not mean-spirited message, but there is a message here. There's a mission here. There is an intent here. Go into all the world and make disciples of the nations, baptizing or immersing them in Allah's name, Shinto's name, in my name. Baptism was a way of acknowledging, not just pledging, but acknowledging your pledge, your alliance, your allegiance to a ruler or to an emperor. Immerse them in my name. We've done this over, and I've said it in passing for years, in the 36, 37 years we've been involved in pastoring, and sometimes I say it so fast, I'm not quite sure if I'm really communicating what I'm really trying to communicate, and that is, sometimes in our effort to really play the logical reasoning game, we fail to really be truly prophetic. There's a point at which the back and forth in the reasoning, somewhere in there, beginning, middle, or end, when it's truly prophetic, it's no longer about whether or not it makes logical sense. It's simply about, thus says the Lord. And if you don't believe in that Lord, you don't believe in this Lord, you think I'm out to lunch, you got to take that up with him. And it's on him to convince you that I'm out here and I'm talking like this because he exists. And what I'm speaking is true. I can't do that. There were people that saw the miracles of Jesus and still did not believe. Some of us don't believe because you haven't seen a miracle. I've seen a few in my lifetime. Right? So I have no doubt that God does that. Absolutely none. I'm tempted to go there. I can't go there. All right? Trying to get y'all out of church so you can get to your roast beef and all the stuff that's waiting on you, pulling on your belly button right now. Okay. But we're devoted to the fulfillment of God's eternal purpose. That's the point Pastor Ray's trying to make here. This special people of God. Right? And what is that purpose? Worshiping him, living in fellowship with him. Loving one another, and making disciples. It's all of that. The Westminster Confession reads, you know, chief end of man is to worship God and enjoy him forever. It's almost like in church, some churches you never even hear that, don't even believe that that's the case. The chief end of man is to suffer until Jesus comes. See, chief end of man, once you give your life to Jesus Christ, is just grin and bear it and put up with it until you can get out of here someday. It's so hard to be saved. It is so difficult. But I tell you, if there was any other way for me to get to heaven, I'd take that route, because I'm telling you right now, this route is really messed up. Now, many of us don't say it like that, but that's the message. That's what's oozing out of our bones. It's so hard. Oh, my goodness. And it's so difficult to resist the temptation of the enemy, because everything in me wants to sin. Everything in me wants to kick it. Get my freak on. Everything in me wants. You're going to say, what's the point of getting saved? What does it mean to be born again? If everything in you, you just in it, oh, it's so hard for me to live right and be obedient to God. Pull on me now. Y'all call me. You pray for me. Put a roadblock in the way. Make sure I don't go, because I'm a beast inside. I just gotta have the world. It's almost like 2 Corinthians 5:17 don't mean nothing. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. All things have passed. That beast thing, all things have passed away. All things have become new. Ah. And the man of God said today, I love him down in my soul. Yes, sir. Somebody wave. Give him a wave offer right now. Say, I love you down in my soul. Yes, I do. I know the world don't understand this. That's because you haven't tasted yet. But I love him down in my soul. I know where I would be if it wasn't for Jesus. And I want you to know, Lord, it's a joy to serve you. Oh, yes, it is. It's a joy to know you. I'm grateful for what you've done in my life. Hallelujah. Yeah. Excuse me there. Glory to the name. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Glory. If it hadn't been for Jesus, where would it be? Where would it be? Where? I'd be a messed up dude, I'm telling you. But oh, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. My God. He did it. He did it for me. Praise the name of Jesus. Okay. Yes, sir. Come out and bless him. Bless him right there. That's a good place to bless him. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You're amazing, Father. You're amazing. You're absolutely amazing. Hallelujah. I'm not saying we're never tempted. What I'm telling you is, because of the power of God on the inside of us now, yes, sir, I found even if I genuflect in the direction that God wants me to go, his grace is there. Come on. Come on. Yes, sir. Praise the name of the Lord. So, this is the race that God's trying to get all of humanity into. That's past this point. This is the race he's trying to get all of humanity in. This one, the born again human beings. Not the snobby, religious, arrogant, prideful. No, that ain't. Mm. That's the group he's trying to get us into. Okay, I think I'm doing this right. Hear what the scripture says. You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who has called you out of darkness. Let's read the rest of it. Into his marvelous light. Who were once, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy. That's who we are. Yeah. Glory to God. I just want to praise him right now. Hallelujah. We bless you, oh God. We thank you, Lord God. You're a mighty God. We glorify you, Lord. You've done for us what no one else could do. Yes, sir. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He says, beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts. Here's our biggest war, y'all. Here's our biggest fight, which war against your soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they would speak evil of you, speak against you as evildoers. That's going to happen from time to time. They may by your own good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. Four words, and then we're going to go. Who is the special people? Who are the privileged people? This is a privilege you're birthed into. You can't earn it. We don't earn it. No. First word is we're chosen. Got that? Chosen generation. The word chosen means that you've been chosen from or out of. It's two words together. Ek meaning out of lektos, meaning to select or to choose. I realize that there are a number of different, for those of you that are, you know, avid readers or maybe even students of theology and so forth, particularly with the influence of people like John Calvin and others, even in our time, who really wrestled with this issue of the difference between sovereign will, the sovereignty of God, and the free will of man, and this whole idea of God choosing people in terms of predestination, destination meaning the horizon or the point at which, and being chosen ahead of time. God says God did that in the foreknowledge of God, knowing our response. So there is this merger of the two. But once we say yes to the Lord, please bear in mind that we came out of something. We were selected out of a mentality, out of a certain culture, so to speak, that's spiritual, to actually be given life and now live in Him. We are a chosen generation. This word is genos. There are no soft G's in New Testament Greek. This word is genos. And it's related to a word, a verb, genomai, which means to become or cause to exist or to come into existence. We are a chosen generation. In this context, it's a word that refers to offspring, family. You'll find the word race attached to this word as well, because typically in the meanings of some of these words, it shares in a family of thought that's important to communicate. You are a called out generation. That's who God's privileged race is, okay? And the call is to everyone. Many are called. Remember that in scripture? Jesus said, many are called, but few are chosen. Why are the few chosen? Because you're better than somebody? No. The chosen ones are the ones who say yes. Yeah, that's simple. It's just that simple. You're a chosen offspring, chosen family member, your chosen race or nation or kind. Okay, let me go on here. You're also a royal priesthood. The word royal there simply means a royal or kingly, a regal priesthood. Priesthood here, hieratuma. It's the order or body of priests, so Christians are called, because they have access to God and offer not external but spiritual sacrifices. Grammarians tell us this from the Theos Greek lexicon. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, the passage we're studying, uses the term basileion, which is really the word for kingdom or kingly, kingly priesthood. Okay? 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, after Exodus 19, 6, and even in the Septuagint, this word is supplied. We are priests of kingly rank. Priests of kingly rank. Speaks of authority, of course, but not just rogue authority, but authority under the authority of God. We've been exalted to a moral rank and freedom which exempts us or them from the control of everyone but God and Christ. Doesn't mean that individuals don't have the authority in government and so forth over us. It just simply means ultimately we're submitting to God. Okay, this whole concept is not found in secular authors who wrote in the Greek language, respected authors. This is unique. Remember I told you God uses sometimes a different dictionary than others? This is why Pastor makes these statements. You say, well, what point does the secular authors have to do? Because that's typically the way that we try to compare the meanings of terms and concepts and so forth. It's very important. I'm going to be later on this year
taking some Saturdays for what I call trigger topics, trigger subjects. One of them is women in ministry and women in leadership. Okay? So, yeah, we're going to go there. We're going to deal with eternal security. We're going to deal with spiritual warfare. We're going to deal with a lot of stuff. And it's going to take too long to do it on Sunday, so I'm going to take some Saturdays. And we're going to come in here, and we're going to get down and get to business because we got work to do, okay? And we all need to be on the same page. Otherwise, the enemy's going to keep doing what he's been doing, and that's dividing us and having us sitting here and dealing with all this mess underground, okay? Okay, Pastor can't go there either. All right, I'll leave that alone. But the point is that a lot of secular authors did not use this term in their writings. And the whole way that many times we come to understand certain concepts is to take a look at not only how it appears in the Bible, but how it also appears in the secular authorship. The credentialed people are the people that had the status of being reputable at the time in their society. When we think in terms then of what it actually means to be a kingly priesthood, this is kind of unique in a real sense to God's people. Priesthood is a priest, is one who offers sacrifices. You read chapter 2, 1 Peter, you see that very clearly. Spiritual sacrifices. And in general, is busy with sacred rites or rituals. It's one who offers a sacrifice to a god. And this is written from the perspective of a person who's just saying this term or this priesthood concept was also pretty common in other religions. It's one who offers a sacrifice to a god in Jewish and pagan religions, and then also of Christians, only metaphorically, right? Because we're not bringing animals and bulls and bowls of grain and that kind of thing. Some people still do that in the present world today. They devote their life to him alone and to Christ. I want to say more about that, but we've got to go. Then the third term I want you to be concept of in terms of this privileged race, these are chosen, these are royal, and now we see this word holy, right? This is a holy people. We've been on that, so you're more familiar, kind of fresh in your mind, a little bit better. Hagios is the Greek term there. Set apart for God. Kadesh or Kadosh is the Old Testament term, Hebrew term. Set apart for God to be, as it were, exclusively his. And I would simply add to walk in that exclusivity, to walk in the very nature of the one who has separated us unto himself. Sometimes in other religions, I don't want to use the word pagan or heathen because sometimes you miss the point. But it's a term that can also be offensive to those who are not in the body of Christ because they think we're putting them down. But for individuals that do not espouse or believe what we believe, this is not some foreign concept. It's a different concept to them. To be impregnated by, to be infused with the thoughts and the concepts of the God or goddess that they worshiped. Of course, with God, God is saying, no, I'm the one that lives in you. And you're walking in and living in my nature. You say, well, who wins? God's already won. It's just a matter of time before it's manifested. You and I are living in that in-between period. We're living in the in-between. We come on the scene and leave the scene before it's really clear and it's final. But Revelation tells us very clearly, when the dust is settled, Jesus will be standing there. There will not be any confusion. Our walk of faith means that we must believe God and trust God until that point, until that happens. And that's difficult because most of us are still locked in from an internal perspective to just, you know, the empirical data that says we win. Until it's physically manifested, it's like, is it really true? Should I be following Jesus? Did I believe the wrong thing? Well, if you're still there, you need to cry out and say, God, show me, help me come to a place of certainty on this. I'm not jumping on your back for being there at all. That's real if that's where you are. But God wants you certain.
Luke writes to his friend Theophilus. He said, hey, I'm writing this to you because this is the stuff that we know certainly happened. This happened. This stuff happened. There was an archaeologist, his name was Sir William Ramsay, who did not believe the Bible. And he set out to disprove its credibility. And he was going to do it by going through the book of Acts and through the Gospel of Luke. And when he came through his study archaeologically, he said he's one of the best historians that's ever lived. He's underrated. Some say that this gentleman gave his life to the Lord. I never read that he did. But if he did, good for him. The evidence is here. You know, we get this misnomer, even sometimes in the things that I say about science, you may get the impression that I don't believe in science or that I don't believe science has its role. Oh, no, God uses science. Yeah, he uses it to put it right in everybody's face. He will do that, okay? Very, very important. But we're set apart for God to be, as it were, exclusively his. My issue is science is not God. That's my issue. That's your pastor's issue. Science is not God. God does not spell his name, S-C-I-E-N-C-E. That's not his name. That's his tool. That's not his name. Praise the Lord. Amen. Okay. Here's the word, holy what? Nation. The Greek term is ethnos. We get our word ethnic from this word. It's a multitude of individuals of the same nature or genus, right? It's a race, a nation, or the nations in Scripture as distinct even sometimes from the nation of Israel. Ethnos is a word that means forming a culture or a custom. Properly, people joined by practicing similar customs or common culture. Nation or nations, usually referring to unbelieving Gentiles or non-Jews. That word was often used for that. But we are a whole, because it includes us, we are a holy, set-apart nation under God. Old King James Version uses this phrase, you're peculiar people. Doesn't mean weird. Doesn't mean you lost your mind. Doesn't mean I lost my mind. The word peculiar, possession, is really kind of the same word. And it literally means a preservation, an acquisition from Strong's Concordance. It means to make one's own. This is what God did with us. To completely obtain something or someone. That is to say, as a full possession to this point, to real advantage for the thing or for the person that's been made that individual's own. It means acquiring or obtaining. It's rendered this way in the Scriptures, or possessing, or possession, or ownership. In the Old Testament, the Hebrew term is segula. I think it's how it's pronounced, segula or segula. It means God said that to Israel in Exodus chapter 19. You are my own possession. The word literally means according, what's the Old Testament Semitic scholar's name? It means, I can't remember his name. It means a movable treasure. It goes with you wherever you go. It's not just something you left back there. No, it moves with you. That's who you and I are. God's privileged people are those who are his peculiar possession. We're his movable treasure. Glory to God. Oh, I want to stay there, but I got to go. And finally, we are his people. We are his peculiar people. And later on in verse 10, we are the people of God. This is the word laos, right? So we got genos, right? I'm taking you back. We're in class now. We got genos. We got heriotuma. Where's my word for priesthood? Okay, that was it. We've got ethnos. And now we have laos. We're the laos of God. He said, well, wait a minute. Aren't all human beings the people of God? From a creation standpoint, yes. That's true. From a new creation standpoint, no. From a natural standpoint, yes. Spiritually speaking, redemptively speaking, no. The privileged ones have been redeemed. have accepted the redemption of God. Okay. I was just going to quote it and go on. Romans chapter 2. Go there. Quick. Glory to God. There are other passages where this reads. Verse 25, circumcision is indeed profitable if you keep the law. But if you are a breaker of the law, your circumcision has become uncircumcision. Verse 26, therefore, if an uncircumcised man keeps the righteous requirements of the law, will not his uncircumcision be counted as circumcision? And will not the physically uncircumcised, if he fulfills the law, judge you who, even with your written code and circumcision, are a transgressor of the law? Verse 28, for he is not a Jew who is one outwardly, nor is circumcision that which is outward in the flesh. You may be born as an Israeli. You may be born Jewish. The terms mean different things to different periods. Okay? But even if you were born into that people group, I won't call that, if you're born into that ethnos, you're not a part of the people of God just by virtue of the fact that you're born there. That's what Paul is saying. That's the meaning of that verse that I just read to you. But he is a Jew who is one inwardly, Jew, from the word Judah, meaning one who praises God with his life and in covenant with God. He is a Jew who is one where? Inwardly. Heart in the spirit, not in the letter, whose praise, from the name playing off the name Judah or Jew, whose praise is not from men, but from God. Yes, it's possible to be born, in this case, it was just amongst the nation of Israel, but it's possible to be born into the world as a human being and literally bear the resemblance of God in the sense that we are made in his image and likeness. But in that state, we are born into the world, infected by sin, still under the condemnation of being born in that state. Deliverance from that state of being, it's not an economic state. It's not racial. Being born into that condition requires rescue. So I can be a human being, a child of God in the sense that I am a part of human nature that he started, and not be a child of God in the sense that I'm a part of the kingdom that he wants me in. Does that make sense to you? That's exactly what we're trying to communicate here. See? Okay, let's go back. That's an interesting study. You should study that out, but I've got to go. I've got to let you go. So as the people of God, we are the laos, the root of the term, English term. We get our word laity from this. That's it. There's nowhere in the Bible calling the people of God the laity of God. That's people talking who haven't, they either don't remember, I'll be nice. Maybe they don't remember. Or maybe they never studied. And nowhere in the Bible, something about the laity. Where do you think they got the term from? The laity of God. A people particularly used of the people of the Lord. The Hebrew term is the word am. When God told Hosea to marry this woman, there was a prostitute, and he bought her and married her and named one of the children Lo, Hebrew term for not. Ami, my people. The people of God. This is a people characteristically of God's chosen people.
First the Jews, then the Christians, sometimes, but rarely the people, just in the crowd. Why? Because God hates them? No. They've not yet either been presented with the distinction in God's mind, or even when it's been presented to them and they're told or taught how to come into this dimension of being the people of God, the privileged people, they say no. We're the people of God. So what does this mean for us? This privileged people has been created not to receive glory and honor to itself. This privileged people has been created to declare the praises of him who brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light. What do you mean by that? We've been created to declare. That means give voice with lip and life to the praises. The word literally translates moral excellencies, the moral virtues of God. This is not just the car God got me or the house he helped me get. This is not about God giving me money alone. That's the little stuff. What we're praising God about is who he is. His virtues. There is none like you. Gods and goddesses of the ancient days and even of the now days were beings that were sometimes very capricious, very pernicious, could be very wicked. People served them out of fear. There's none like unto you. You love us with an everlasting love. You're the Lord of everlasting and eternal covenant. You forgive our iniquities. You cleanse us. You make us free. You have our best interest at heart. You've given your best for us. Yes, we declare his moral excellencies. We're created to declare, give voice through our lips, through our lives, that is, in praise of his excellencies, of his moral virtues. We're created to declare this about the one who brought us out of darkness. The word in scripture for darkness means ignorance. He brought us out of darkness. It also means sin. It also has to do with satanic and demonic dominion, witchcraft, the occult. We praise you in your moral excellencies. You're holy, you're pure, you're righteous. You brought us out of ignorance. You brought us out of satanic and demonic dominion. You've delivered us from sin and all of his forces. You brought us into your marvelous light. What is that? His truth, his understanding, his wisdom. And then you can talk a little bit about how powerful just even the sunlight is. That's who we are. And this is the ethnos. This is the generation. This is the priesthood. This is the peculiar possession. This is the laos of God. These are the ones. These are the ones. You know, let me say it another way. These are the ones he came to make us all into. We exist to be a praise. One writer put it as a trophy, or a testimony to God's glorious grace and to his glory. We exist to live and to assist in total human flourishing. You know, when sometimes I was growing up in church, I thought being a praise unto God meant being here to lift our hands. Let's bless the Lord. Let's bless the Lord. And that's true. We are. But we're also called to assist in the total human flourishing of our society. Jesus went about, the Bible says, he was anointed of the Holy Ghost. He went about doing good, healing all those who were oppressed of the devil. 1 Peter chapter 2 tells us we've been called for this purpose, to walk in his steps. Whether you're an engineer or an architect or a medical personnel, or you're working as a school teacher, your mom, your dad, we're called, we're involved to help in the total human flourishing of every person. There are many who wonder whether or not those of us who particularly are the charismatic and Pentecostal persuasions in the Lord's church, whether or not we care about the human flourishing. of everybody. Oh, well, now we just want their money, and we just want them to come and sit in our services and help sell our books and our stuff. No, no, no. He's concerned about you flourishing, body, mind, emotions, spirit, personally and relationally, every aspect of your being. There's a lot of criticism, and you know, some of it is merited, for the way that some ministers have gone and how they teach in local churches. It's more topical, and it sounds more like mentoring and coaching. But this is what they're trying to do. They're trying to address the physical and the mental and the emotional, the intellectual, the every aspect of the being of a person. I mean, talk about marriage and talk about family and talk about getting jobs and talk about starting businesses, talking about going into politics, doing everything we can, not so we can make money, but for the flourishing of humanity. Paul taught us to pray, lift up holy hands, pray for those who are in authority, that we may live quiet and peaceable and lives of dignity. And then he goes on and says, it's God's will that everyone be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. So it's not salvation or this, it's salvation and this. Yes, it's all of it. Finally, we end here. Acts 17, verse 22 through 34, Paul went to Athens to minister, and they went there to minister. The scripture says he got to Athens. We were in Athens last year, and he gets to Athens, and he sees all these idol gods and statues everywhere. And he says, I perceive that you are very religious. Well, the phrase there really means, I see that you really have a respect for it. A fear for it is translated, but it's really the word also for respect. And they were kind of like Americans, some Americans. They were trying to respect all religions. And so there was, and so they get, just in case we missed, just in case we missed somebody. We don't want to offend anybody. Everybody's, you know, religious expressions and spirituality is cool. So he finds an altar, and on this altar there's an inscription to an unknown God. Because they had enough sense to realize that all these statues and all of this worship, there could still possibly be one that we missed. And Paul said, I want to talk to you about him. See, because when you get him, all the rest of these statues can come down. Praise the name of the Lord. I used to do a message called The Faces of Worship. And this is one that's called, it comes from the word agnao, and it means, we get our word agnostic. He says, the one you are ignorantly worshiping. There's such a thing as a face called ignorant worship. We don't know. There's something out there somewhere, some way, something. I want to talk to you about. Many of you remember that story. He begins to teach and talk to them. It's very, very clear. Very, very clear message. What comes through this passage is important for us to see. In verse 26, there's one race, many people. Verse 27 and 28, there's one purpose for our existence. Verse 22 through 25, and then verse 29. There's the same problem in every human. In the last few verses there's only one universal viable solution. It's there. That was his message. There's one race. He has made from one blood the ethnos. Same word. The many people groups came out of one blood. There's one human race, many ethnic groups. There's one purpose. What did he make you for? To seek the Lord, and that you would find him. What is that? What does that mean? The word seek doesn't mean I'm looking around. It can, but it means that you would worship him. You were made to worship him. You were made to worship him. You were made to worship him. You were created to worship him. Yes.
My brother, when he was alive, he and Pat's sister dead over there, they was leading the school, and he created a theme for all the children. I was born to worship God. What's the rest of it? With perfect praise in my generation. He still knows it. He was a little boy in the school at the time, my nephew. I was born to worship God with perfect praise. Can you imagine what would happen if all the little boys and little girls in St. Louis was taught that? You're not an accident. You may be the result of a rape or incest. Somebody may have dropped you off at the hospital. But if you are here, you were born to worship God with perfect praise. Hallelujah. Oh, I feel Jesus in the room right now. He goes on to tell him, your poets have written about it. In him, we live and move, have our being. You say, well, doesn't that tell us, Pastor, that kind of contradicts what you just said, Pastor, that there are some who are just natural, and there are some that are spiritual. No, I said, the poets wrote about it. The poets didn't understand what they were writing about. They told the truth on that point. But they didn't tell the truth about how to get there the way God wanted it to be. I got to read that. And then we're done. Acts chapter 17. Go there with me. Here's the same problem. Don't take that off. I'll read it. Here's the same problem in every human. Got it? Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you're very religious. You're very respectful of religions, even fearful. For as I was passing through and considering the objects of your worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God. Here's the common problem. Therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing or ignorantly, him or agnostically, I proclaim to you. Him I proclaim to you. Not it I proclaim to you. Him I proclaim to you. God, who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands. Same problem in every human. Same problem. I have crafted God according to my own imagery, or according to what has been fed to me through the mouth of those who never knew him. Verse 25, nor is he worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives to all life, breath, and all things. He has made from one blood every nation of men. See, this is the problem. This is the problem. I'll skip those verses. I already told you about them. Jump down to verse 29. For we also are his offspring. Therefore, you have to bring this up. Bring this up for me, Candace. Bring this one up. Verse 29, Acts chapter 17, verse 29. Because this is the problem. This is our problem. And I can wait 20 seconds because you got to see the problem. Right? All right, we're there. Verse 1, therefore, since we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think or reason that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, something shaped by art and man's devising. This is our problem when it comes to God. It's a sin-induced sin. It's the result of being sinful. Does art imitate life? Or does life imitate art? Art is created. Life is. Does art simply imitate what is? Or is what is imitating the art? Therefore, since we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think
Don't calculate and come to the reasoned conclusion that the divine nature, a phrase meaning God, the creator, is the what is like gold or silver or stone or something shaped by art and man's imagination.
Miss Upra. Paul goes on to say, let's go on to the next verse. Truly, these times of ignorance. What times of ignorance? That the divine nature was created through the artistic way and the reasoning and the fashioning of man's imagination. These times of ignorance. See, God's commentary on all of that creativity, that it came out of ignorance. That's an insult to us today. But God says, all that stuff y'all made, all those temples and all that, that's the fruit of ignorance. What's ignorance? Ignorance is not stupidity. Ignorance means to be unaware or to be unlearned or I don't know. It came out of your not knowing. It was guessing. Demonically influenced guessing. Satanically influenced guessing. It was made up. These times of ignorance God overlooked. Well, King James Version says he winked at it. But now commands all men everywhere to repent. Change your mind. Turn. You misinterpreted. You misunderstood. You misdiagnosed. So you've been misapplying yourself toward this whole thing of spirituality and coming to know what it means to be related to your creator. You've got it all backwards. It's the fruit of your ignorance that led to all that. You think you're pleasing God with all this? You think you're somehow appeasing and your conscience is being... No. You're still out there. You're still struggling for a sense of reality that results in peace inside of you. It's everywhere. It's all over the world. It's all over the world. And some have made up their mind, you can't know anything else, so they've resolved, they're at peace. They're at peace. But we know the truth. We know the truth. Why would a person who's an atheist spend your life going around trying to tell everybody that there is no God if there is no God? There's no God. Why are you on a crusade to let us all know that there isn't one? We'll come to the same conclusion you came to. You're trying to save me? From what? To what? Why, Mr. Harris, is it so important that I be delivered from my obsession with God? If there is no God. Because you know. You've convinced yourself through your own con, but your own con is not enough convincing work of your inner man. You know. These times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent. Next verse, please. Because he has appointed the day on which he will judge the world in righteousness. Okay, so if everybody's already in, there's no need to judge the world in righteousness. There's no need for repentance. Paul is saying, your poets wrote about it, but here's the part they couldn't give you because they've been operating in ignorance. They had enough sense to realize that we are his offspring, but they don't see the full picture. There's something we as his offspring needed to do. Yes, we are the result of the procreative process that he created. Okay? That's true. We're the result of that. But we need to be recreated. We need to be born again. He will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. Next verse tells us the response. Thank you, Brother Paul,
Thank you for coming and telling us that we're ignorant. Thank you for coming and telling us that we got it all wrong. I'd love to support your ministry, Brother Paul. No, here's what they said. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked him. Others said, we will hear you again on this matter. That was the response. Ha! You're crazy. You must think we're stupid. Ain't nobody got up from the grave. That was the response. It wasn't, just as I am without one plea, but just come. No. You crazy! That was the first response. Second response was, hey, can we talk about this some more? Still wasn't believing, but I do want to hear a little bit more about it. Something happened. Next verse, please. So Paul departed from them. Did I miss the verse? Go ahead, verse 34. However, some men joined him. That's the third response. Mockery. Let's talk about it some more. Some joined him and believed. There we go, people. Here we go, people of God. Some became a part of the chosen. Some became a part of the royal priesthood. Some became a part of the holy nation. Some became a part of that peculiar possession. They became a part of that privileged people. That's what the Lord wants for the nations of the earth. We passed by Dionysus, the temple they created for him there. Okay? This is all I have for you today, and I believe... I got just one final word, and then we're going to pray and go. You can stand and rest on your feet for this, because I'm just going to read it. This is so important for the will of God for our lives. Amen. It's so important. Here's what God's view for the world is. It's his desire for the world. The elevation of the human race to the highest quality of life through Jesus Christ. That's his desire. Elevation through regeneration. Elevation through transformation. Elevation through salvation. Elevation. All the rest of the stuff leads to a demotion. Doesn't produce the kind of people who promote the general welfare and ensure domestic tranquility, because there is no peace where Jesus is not king. Father, thank you for the word. Thank you for the ministry. Thank you for this time. Thank you for the word. Thank you for the ministry. Thank you for this time. We pray that our hearts and our lives, God, would be living letters, undeniable proof, blazing, radiant trophies as praise unto you. We surrender our lives to you because of the marvelous one that you are, the unsurpassable plan that you have worked throughout the earth. We bless you for sending Jesus. Praise you for the word of the living God. Regardless of the response, we're committed this day, whether we face mockery or those who simply want to question it a little bit further, others, Lord, who may really join and believe. We're committed to the elevation of humanity, total human flourishing. It's not only the physical and the mental and the emotional needs that are there are met, but where the spiritual craving and longing and yearning for the reality of you is finally planted in each life. Thank you for this grace today. As we leave, as we go forward, I pray, Lord, that throughout our nation, with all of the vast agendas for Black America,
and for the larger family of America. We pray that this gospel would be released in a new potency, in a new power. We stand with you against the will of Satan and all of the demonic and satanic wisdom that has us in consternation and brokenness and woundedness of heart. We lift up our lives to you. We present ourselves to you along with untold millions, even billions around this world who have said yes to you. Let it be so. Let it be so that we are found faithful to the will of God. Take a moment, if you will, please, before the Lord, and just declare your own commitment to Christ in light of maybe one or two things that you've heard today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for making us a part. We bless your name. And while these are praying, if you're still watching, and you're a part of what God is doing today in your life, I want you to know that God really does. He really does have you at heart. He loves you. He wants you in this special race of people. He's not willing that you perish, that you be ruined. And so the decision of whether or not that happens is totally up to you. You have the narratives, the philosophies, the beliefs that have been transmitted, yes, thousands of years. And in the midst of that, that one message, that he alone is the way. If by the work of God's Spirit you've been convinced that this word is true, that he is true, he calls you into a relationship with himself. If you want that relationship with Jesus, I would be honored, indeed privileged, to lead you into that relationship with him right now. We like to do it around here in prayer. It simply means talking to God and listening to God. But what we're going to do is I'm going to ask you to release your faith, that confidence that you have, that persuasion that you have, in a form of trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. If you'll do that, here's what he said. But to many as believed him, trusted him, to them and received him, he gives the right to become children of God. If you want to do that, you can do it right now, right here, in this moment. This is what your heart is craving. This is what it's looking for. And I encourage you to do it with me. Would you say it with me? Lord God, I take you at your word. You sent Jesus to die on a cross in my place because of my sinful condition. He was buried in the ground for me. And as proof that he had made the right sacrifice, a completed sacrifice, he was raised from the dead. Lord, I believe that. I believe it was all done for me. And so I refuse to be an ignorant worshiper, to be an agnostic worshiper. I yield my heart, my life to you. I receive you now as Lord and Savior of my life. Thank you. Thank you for making me a part of the human race. And now, of the redeemed race. It's a privileged race. And Lord, I want others in my family and my friends to be a part of this race. In the name of Jesus, help me to grow. Help me to know. Help me to serve you. I love you, God. Thank you for coming to live in me. Thank you, Jesus. As believers now, would you join me? Just lift your hands to God and say, Lord, I'm committed to your message, to your ministry, the parts you've given me in it, for there multiplied thousands that you have called me to reach. There are others that you want to be a part of this redeemed, devoted, privileged race of people. Thank you, Jesus. I count myself truly blessed to be a part of what you're doing. Thank you, God. Amen and amen. The Lord bless you, and the Lord keep you, and the Lord make his face to shine upon you.
The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord, what? Give you his peace. Go in the name of the Lord. Looking forward to the prayer time again this week. Be faithful unto God. God bless. Bless the Lord.
Come on, help me say, God is the God.